actually two of them are presenting today. Paul and Susan are members of our committee, and we can always use more people. We're looking for folks from Idaho who are underrepresented right now. So you can get in touch with Michael Rainey or with me if you're interested in joining. So today's presentation, we have three case histories of facilities in the region that are leading the way into actually implementing projects that are expanding the biogas world. You'll notice that while one of these three plants is actually a medium facility, the other two are definitely in the large range, not in small. The reason for this is that both of these have a record of really innovative work on biogas, and they're leading the way for smaller systems. As I'll note later, there are technical obstacles for implementation of some of these methods, and they tend to be favorable for large. And so these guys are doing stuff that we think will give us valuable lessons to be learned. All these might be applicable to smaller and medium facilities.
Brian, this is Mike. Could I interrupt for a moment?
Go ahead.
Brian, this is Mike. Could I interrupt for a moment?
Go ahead.
It sounds like we're getting some extraneous sound that wasn't there on the practice, so I'm not sure what it is, but I can't see that it's coming from somebody else's station. It sounds kind of like a mechanical sound there. I'm not sure what it might be. But we'll try to get in here. So sorry for the interruption. Go ahead.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Okay, first of all, I'm going to recap some of the slides that we started last year's webinar with. First of all, a reminder of why we're here. All the focus on is really hard for most people, including plant managers and the public, to see what appears to be a wasted resource just go up in flame. Probably all of us have flares, and I kind of hate to see that every day. This one happens to be a photo from Grand Junction, Colorado. From last year, and you'll see that they were bragging at the time that they were implementing a PNG project that they claimed was the first of its kind in the nation to capture excess digester gas and convert it into fuel for fleet usage. And we'll hear later today about that implementing one of our plants here. So here's an outline for today. Our first speaker is Paul Proctor from Veolia Water. And he's talking about the energy independence program at the Gresham wastewater plant that's based primarily on use of fog. The second presentation will be Scott Drennen and Susan Hildreth, the King County Wastewater Treatment Division, who will be talking about a number of the innovative approaches that have been implemented at the South Plant, also known as the Renton Plant to a lot of folks. And they are joined by Pete Carter, who's in the room to help answer questions as they might come along later. And then Muriel Gisa Teufel and Jim Brown of Portland BES are going to share their stories of technologies that have been implemented and evaluated at the Columbia Boulevard Wastewater Treatment Plant in Portland. And as time permits during the program, we will be able to entertain a few questions following each presentation. And at the end, we're going to try to reserve some time for more questions. So I'm going to turn it over now to Paul, and he can give his presentation on the Gresham facility.
Good morning. Thank you for joining us today. My name is Paul Proctor. I'm going to be sharing some information on the Gresham Oregon project. I was the project manager there from 2005 to 2013. And during that time, the city of Gresham made a real serious commitment in their vision, time, and money towards sustainability of the city operations, including the wastewater treatment plant. The Gresham plant serves a population of about 114,000. It's a 20 MGD design capacity. Currently, it's about 13 million gallons per day. Conventional activated sludge treatment plant, anaerobic digestion, belt filter presses, chlorination and dechlorination. Over the years, the city has been, in my experience, very proactive in ensuring the plant capacity was always being met. But they're always keeping an eye on the total operations cost for energy and maintenance, repair cost, and operational capability. The most recent major construction was completed in 2012, consisting of a number of energy-producing and energy-saving technologies. We'll be talking about that a little bit more. From this photo, you can see some of the major unit processes out there. And of course, the most outstanding one is the solar array complex. It's on the south side of the plant. It's pretty impressive. In 2012 and 2014, there were some minor projects that were completed to install a fat grease receiving station. And that is, phase two is actually completed now. The plant is currently staffed with 17 employees with Veolia, and then there are three city engineers on site. In 2009, the city adopted their final sustainability policy that would promote community health and well-being, support, you know, stable, diverse, and equitable economy, and protect and improve quality of air, water, land, and natural resources. And I think the important thing I take away from this is that having that top-down support from the city leadership and their vision and drive to support green and sustainable approach made the goal of sustainability not only doable but achievable. And I think today Gresham is known as a green city. The city of Gresham primary goals at the wastewater plant will be focusing primarily on goals number one and two, which is 80% reduction of the greenhouse gas emissions by 2050 and 100% renewable energy by 2030. And some of the other ones, zero waste, waste minimization, ongoing protection of our natural resources, and toxic reduction and elimination. Here's the cogen unit that was installed in 2005. This is kind of the first step towards energy independence. Overall, this unit has been very reliable. It goes down only mainly for oil changes and media changeout. We've had one top end rebuild, one major overhaul in 8 years. We've had some issues with electrical, specifically with some of the ice cube relays failing from vibration. We've had some wear on the internal wiring and failures due to vibration causing a short to ground. These problems were addressed by wrapping the generator wires internally and then moving the control wires from a conduit that was going into the ground and moving that to an overhead cable tray. The major cost of the life of this machine, if you add it all up over time, is actually the oil changes, spark plugs, and spark plug wires. And just a reminder, this is not a diesel, or this is not a diesel unit, so it has spark plugs and wires. Therefore, after the warranty period, and the warranty required you change the oil, spark plugs, wires every 1,000 hours, and that was very expensive. And so we started doing oil analysis, and then which finally ultimately extended out the oil changes to about every 2,000 hours. On this slide, we have some of our key numbers for the cogeneration system through August of 2013. 93% uptime is a significant number for Veolia. As per our contract with the city, we guarantee a 90% uptime. And if we were to drop below 85%, then Veolia would be on the hook for all the lost electrical production. In addition to providing about half of the plant power, the waste heat from the engine is used to heat the digester, some external buildings. Also, the heat loop off the digester is used to heat the fog that's coming into the plant, or coming into the digester. And the preheating of the fog helps it flow better and does reduce the shock to the digester. The power cost on the utility company, we're currently paying at about 9 cents a kilowatt. On the engine generator side, a good point to note is that we got about 60,000 hours of operational time before we had to do the major overhaul, which is about 20,000 hours more than what was called out in the O&M guidelines. And we attribute the success and the whole success of this program for the cogenerator has really been tied to the gas treatment system. It removes hydrogen sulfide, siloxane, and then we also dry it so that we get the moisture out of it. The cost of the cogen power production runs about 3 cents per kilowatt, and that includes everything, the PM, RPMs, our labor, our media, and our repairs. Since some of the major stepping stones to energy independence are shown on this slide, and in the early 2000s, the leadership of Gresham made a decision to push the city toward reducing their carbon footprint. And it was determined during the analysis that the city wastewater treatment plant had the largest footprint, mostly related to the electrical usage. The city wastewater plant has been in cogeneration for a number of years. However, the unit they had there at the time was a 250 kW Waukesha unit. It did not have gas treatment, and it was only operational about 50% of the time. And the cost to maintain the unit was becoming prohibitive. On about 2004, the first step toward energy independence was to replace the old cogen unit with a new state-of-the-art internal combustion engine to take advantage of the methane being produced by the city's anaerobic digesters. The new cogen went online in November of 2005. I remember it clearly. We had a nice ribbon-cutting ceremony for the mayor. And the immediate result is we saw the electric bill drop from about $44,000 per month to about $20,000 per month, which was significant. Continuing forward, the city negotiated a deal to have a solar array installed at no cost to the city for the next 20 years. The deal is that they have to buy the power from the array at about 6 cents a kilowatt hour, which is about a 30% savings over the utility rate. 2011, the city began construction process to improve reliability of the plant and reduce energy. Some of the main technologies that they employed were replacing our Hoffman centrifugal blowers, our process blowers with high-speed turbo-type blowers, replacing our aeration diffusers in the lower plant with fine bubble diffusers, and replacing the digester mixing from gas compressors with an energy-efficient linear motion mixer. And another key element in achieving energy savings and independence is that we have monthly meetings with the client to review and discuss key data, make sure we're staying on track, and then discuss ideas for any potential projects that further reduce energy. It is planned that by the end of this year, they're going to start installing a second cogenerator unit, and that we will have sufficient gas and power production to be energy independent probably early by next year. This is a couple of SCADA screens I liked when I was there. I like to look at almost on a daily basis. It's a good operational review to look at your digesters and look at your digester gas pressure, how the performance of the digester is doing, the mixture of the mixers are working properly. You've got good temperatures. And very useful screen. We've got a number of these in our SCADA system to provide information to the operators. I like this screen. This one is kind of our gas treatment system. Shows information related to the biogas flow through the biogas treatment system to remove moisture, H2S with our iron sponge media, siloxane is removed via a pelletized carbon and pressurized to meet the engine needs. And in the lower left-hand corner, you can see very useful bit of information showing the plant demand, utility import, which is a really tiny number, and many days now that number is zero, or it might even be negative, and then the output of our generator. This is a kind of an outside view of the gas treatment system. The two siloxane tanks can be run in series or in parallel. And the iron sponge media tank, the siloxane tanks generally last about a year before we have to change them out. And the iron sponge, about 100 days, or that's our goal. We do monitor the hydrogen sulfide coming out of the bottom of the tank to ensure that we're getting good removal. And if it starts to break through, then we schedule a change-up. And when we go to the phase two of the cogeneration with a second unit, we're not going to be adding any more equipment. It just means that we'll have to change the media out more often. 2012, we went into the fog business, and the city decided to reach energy independence. We really needed to increase our biogas production. The digesters did have some excess capacity. They evaluated that and therefore decided to construct and operate these receiving stations. First phase included an offload pump, 350 gallons a minute, grinder, Vulcan tank grinder, recirculating in an insulated 12,000 gallon tank. And then we had a heat exchanger coming off the digester water loop to heat up the fog. The city wanted to really make sure that they had some reputable and reliable haulers for fog, the potential for bringing in toxic or some nasty stuff was very real, so they really, you know, wanted to focus on getting reputable people coming in and selected, pre-selected, and we ended up with three haulers that have to pay a tipping fee of about 8 cents a gallon. They are required to be part of the local preferred pumper program. They have to sign off on a haulers agreement, agreeing to certain requirements, and then, of course, pay their bills on time. Some of the challenges have been in the scheduling with some of the haulers. They like to get out there early, and sometimes we would find them waiting at the front gate in the morning or in 8-hour day operations, basically. And or they would want to bring in a load late in the afternoon, which could, you know, conceivably push us in to have guys stay over on overtime. Ensuring that we were getting, we were also having some issues to ensure that we weren't getting waste that was too thick or too volatile. That could become a problem with pumping, just pumping the material, or overloading our digesters. Other issues were excessive amount of rock and grit coming into the system, and at times some of the haulers were not adhering to the rules of offloading. Looking at some of our charting, and this is these charts are updated every month by the city. I'm not going to show you all of them. They do a number of different data points, but some good information here is looking at our fog deliveries. Initially ramping up, excuse me, in the early of 2013, and started building up to the goal. It was estimated that we were going to need about 10,000 gallons per day to produce enough excess biogas to run a second engine generator. Here's a continuation of the biogas production through phase two. And then through the winter months, you know, we're doing some construction work and things were kind of slowing down. And then they went online with phase two with a second tank and back up to normal deliveries. I think it was April of 2014. And we're seeing production now is back up and above the requirements that as needed for our energy independence. Some of the breakout of hauling by our haulers. You can see we've had two fairly stable haulers, and we've had one major upswing with one hauler, River City, when they began to start hauling dairy waste from dairy gold products. Mostly it's like milk waste and whey product. Revenue coming in is steadily increasing and becoming stable over time. It's about $24,000 a month at this time. And this is a key component for the city to help pay off the fog capital costs in a reasonable amount of time. I believe they were estimating about 5 to 8 years to have this paid off. Looking at our biogas production, initially not fully coming up to where we needed. We did have some little bump back in the middle of last year where production was up and we were getting a lot of heavy loads, but one of the challenges that was a very variable, and as you, if you know digesters, they don't like to be changed a lot rapidly. And then it dropped back down. And one of the issues was just having one tank for storage. And so that really drove us to going into phase two, which brought on a second storage tank. As you can see here, again, our production was down a bit during the winter months for construction. And then going online, phase two, and now we're above the requirements for energy independence on the gas side, production side. Volatility is an important part and factor to ensure fast breakdown of our waste and good gas production. And it has improved by getting more consistent loads, and they're not too thick and not too watery, and with the addition of the milk waste product, which has been a very stable source for us. pH of the fog was being shown here for the three different haulers. And the city knew going into this process that pH was going to be a factor, considering to be considered in the design of the equipment, typically in the 4 to 5 range. They, before we even went into this, they did a whole bunch of testing and evaluation of the different types of fog to see what it was like. However, we did learn that there's a combination of the low pH and the high abrasive nature of the waste did accelerate the wear on equipment a lot faster than we expected. From an operational standpoint, all operators are always concerned about their volatility and alkalinity ratio. Excessive feed can increase your acid formation and quickly lower your alkalinity of your digester and potentially create an upset and foaming. And we had those conditions a couple of times where we got some pretty heavy loads coming in. So it's something we monitor very closely and are always trying to operate the digester to not create those conditions. Key for operational control really to spread out the injection of the fog over a 24-hour period to dampen the effects of that rich food source. And that's what the second storage tank really gives us the ability to kind of provide some dampening of the effect of the fog coming in and spreading it out over time. And operators are happy with that. Here's looking at the ratio over time. And again, fairly stable, and again, in a pretty good range more recently, and now that we have the second tank, provides some additional cushion. Biogas production per gallon, typically we're in the, like the 10 to 12 standard cubic feet of gas produced per gallon of fog that's coming in. I do note that in April and May of this year that is on the upswing. So that's good. More gas with less is a good thing for us. And then looking at our production, biogas production and rate, again, the goal overall for the digester is to produce 280,000 standard cubic feet a day of biogas, and right now we're at that point, which means that opens the door for us to move into the final phase, which is to bring in a second engine generator and install that to take advantage of this extra gas production. Some of the numbers are listed out here. Phase one was about $1 million. I haven't seen the final numbers for phase two, but we're doing this presentation later again this year, and when I get that information, I'll add it to the presentation here. The city is very aggressive on getting grant money, utilized whenever possible, and covered about 25% of the cost of phase one. Like as I said, phase two is pretty much complete with the fog system, showing that it works, and then the next step is the second cogen unit, which is going to be a twin of the cogenerator that we have right now, and get that installed and then drive that cost down from $20,000 a month to $0 on the utility side. some of the upsides in fog for us have been our overall methane production is up by 15. It's probably up higher than that now. Maybe 20 to 25%. Volatile solids destruction in our digester has increased by about 10%. It's a good source of income, revenue for the city to help pay off this capital project. It actually does help the haulers because sometimes in getting rid of fog and various sources, they were paying more than 8 cents a gallon and had difficulty finding places to take it. And then it will take us to energy independence. And again, as I said, seeing a utility bill going from 40 to zero is a pretty impressive thing to be talking about. Some of the downsides, there's always a downside. Scheduling and the consistency of the loads, again, working with the haulers to make sure that they stay within our time frames and they're delivering loads that to meet the requirements of the system. The operational and maintenance demands of phase one were quite a bit higher, doing equipment repairs and wearing out the vocal sand grinders, for example, which instead of changing them out once a year, every 6 months, I believe they're doing it like every 60 days. So there's concern there, and I know in phase two they were moving towards like all hardened and stainless steel type equipment to hold up better under that abrasive nature. And then the digester capacity, I mean, it does take up digester capacity. So the city of Gresham's growth has been fairly slow and stable, but if you're in a fast-growing community and you need that digester capacity, that's something for your consideration. Here's a look at the fog grinder shaft. I'm kind of a mechanical guy, and when we first started this thing up back in 2012, first thing I heard was rocks running through the pump, banging away, and I thought, oh, that's not good, you know, and it isn't good. We've seen the evidence of that. We get a lot of grit. Fog tank, we're ending up having to clean that out. I think we're doing that on a monthly basis to get all the grit out of there. With the second tank, that will extend the time that we will have to do that. And then we're also getting, to me, I believe it's like aggregate that's coming from inside the grease pit. They are concrete walls, and a lot of them times they're exposed to aggregate. Aggregate's falling into the pit, gets sucked up by the pumper, and then gets brought into the system. Here's a look at the grinder screen. Again, it's almost paper thin and sections missing just from the excessive amount of wear. And the grinder blade, again, showing a lot of wear in a relatively short period of time. And as I said, working with the supplier of the equipment and the design engineers to make the equipment more durable and also to look at ways that we can remove the grit and rocks out of the system before we get into this part of the plant. Some of the other food sources the city has been looking at, Dirigold waste, in fact, worked out good, and we are using, bringing in their waste product. Waste management, slurried waste, vitamin pill production. They use a lot of sugar when they're making vitamin pills, so they have that waste product stream. Trub from beer and cherry brine waste. They did do some pilot testing on that, and it did not work out. It was not, the digester did not like that at all. And then yogurt waste. And then this is one of the screens that I like. It just, again, shows the top line here is the overall energy consumption, regardless of the energy source. And you can see the overall trend has been down. And then lower below we have, in the red is our cogenerator production, very stable over this last, you know, like 8 months now after we did our major rebuild. Utility import in blue. And then down below we have the solar, which is really, of course, depends on the time of year and the length of the day. Breakout of power sources at the end of the year, and the bulk of it's being supplied by cogenerator and solar. Some of our major accomplishments, I'm not going to read them all. I just say that, you know, we've done a very successful job in producing energy and using the gas production and increasing gas production. City's been very aggressive on going after grants and getting like $2.2 million worth of grants on $8 million worth of construction. Seeing significant increase in our energy production and reducing our energy cost. Some of the next steps, we'll continue to have team meetings with the city. Fog phase two is completed, and then cogenerator phase two will be going in and hopefully starting up by January of 2015, continuing to evaluate further projects. And that's pretty much all I have. My contact information is on this slide, paul.proctor@veolia.com, if you wish to ask me any questions on the slide. Thank you.
Thank you, Paul. We'll move into the next presentation now with Susan and Scott from King County.
Good morning. Good morning. Are you ready? Are we ready to go?
Yes.
Okay, so we're here this morning to talk about biogas utilization at King County South Treatment Plant. My name is Sue Hildreth, and I'm a project manager for our capital program.
My name is Scott Drennen. I'm the day operations dewatering supervisor here at South Plant.
And we also have Pete Carter sitting in. He's our process engineer at South Plant, and he'll be available to answer questions if we have time at the end. I also want to credit Brown and Caldwell, Jack Warburton, and Aaron Jacobson and Ian McKelvey. A lot of the information in this presentation is from a study done by Brown and Caldwell. We are looking at the future of our digester gas system here at South Plant. So the King County Wastewater Division treats an average of 175 million gallons of wastewater per day at three regional plants and two community-based plants, serving 1.5 million residents. King County has enacted ordinances to reduce carbon emissions and energy consumption and to increase reliance on renewable energy. WTD, the Wastewater Treatment Division's facilities, account for about 58% of all of King County government's facilities' energy usage. And the Wastewater Treatment Division's energy consumption is primarily electric, about 70% electricity consumption. And this puts pressure on us to reduce energy or electricity consumption, but we'll, as we'll talk about, we have a little different situation here at South Plant. The South Treatment Plant serves a population of 600,000 people. Was built in 1965 with liquid stream only. The solid stream was added in 1987. You can see our flows there, average wet weather 115 MGD, average dry weather 96 MGD. Our location offers a unique opportunity related to digester gas utilization. This is a photograph of the plant, and you can see the four digesters in the foreground and the fifth storage tank. The South Treatment Plant has four active 100-foot diameter digesters with a mesophilic process, floating covers with a fixed cover storage tank. We digest primary and waste activated sludge. Average annual hydraulic loading is 289,000 gallons per day. Solids loading 158,000 pounds per day. Volatile solids loading 132,000 pounds per day. Our primary use of digester gas is export of pipeline quality gas to the local utility. We use a high-pressure water solvent type scrubber. We sold 180 billion BTUs, that's 1.8 therms, in 2012. That averages about 840,000 standard cubic feet per day. The scrub gas also fires a hot water boiler. We have three waste gas burners. We have two 3.5 megawatt CHP turbines for peak power shaving or backup heat and or backup heat. We don't have any storage. So we engaged Brown and Caldwell for an in-depth study to determine the best mix of uses to guide future modifications in the context of the county's energy goals. The guiding objectives were to improve system component performance, efficiency, and reliability, maximize cost effectiveness and environmental benefit, and contribute to the targets and goals established by the county. It started with a thorough review of the existing system. The focus of this presentation will be the unique opportunities and trade-offs related to scrubbers and plant heat due to the siting of the plant near a major natural gas pipeline. Here's a rough schematic of our system to summarize what I've just been saying. The digesters send gas primarily to a gas scrubber that is sold to PSE. Any off-spec gas, that is gas that doesn't meet the local utilities requirements, is sent to waste gas burners. We also can send scrub gas to the CHP turbines or to a boiler, which is our primary source of plant heat. We also have historically heat extractors that we'll be going into in more detail for plant process and space heating.
Hello, this is Scott Drennen, and I'll be taking these next slides here from Susan. Our plant was originally expanded in 1987 with a solid stream, and we utilized a biomass high-pressure water solvent type gas scrubbing system. I had two trains that can process approximately 1.2 million standard cubic feet per day through each train. We remove primarily carbon dioxide and hydrogen sulfide. We use two packed media towers followed by a temperature pressure swing absorption gas dryers to remove the moisture for the out of the gas and to prepare it for sale for Puget Sound Energy. We utilize a gas monitoring system and use mercaptan to odorize the gas prior to sale to Puget Sound Energy. Our situation is very unique. We are located near a Puget Sound Energy natural gas pipeline, so we have the ability to utilize our gas as a resource for resale. And in 1987, through our analysis, we determined that it would be more cost-effective for us to run electrically driven heat extractors and sell our gas in lieu of producing our plant heat needs with natural gas. This is a picture of our two scrubbing water solvent scrubbing towers. They utilize plastic media. Gas comes in through the bottom of the tower and is pressurized at 300 psi to flow upward through the tower, and water is pressurized through the top to flow downward and scrubs the carbon dioxide and hydrogen sulfide from the gas prior to going to the dryers. With our gas scrubbing, we have three two-stage reciprocating gas compressors. They compress the gas up to 305 PSIG. Two of the compressors are 150 horsepower, and our latest upgraded compressor is at 350 horsepower. We operate three scrubbing water pumps at 350 PSIG, and respectively they have 200 and 250 horsepower, and produce 550 to 600 gallons per minute. One of the unique features of this scrubbing system is that we recover the energy of the water as it flows back through the tower, and we slow that, and we recapture that energy as it flows through the turbines to help power the pumps. These compressors, at the time of their installation, were cutting-edge technology. They with the two stages, they're able to load single stage or double stage, so 50% and 100% output, and also offer a recirculation feature. They've been on operation since 1987 and are part of our process safety management program, so they're meticulously maintained and kept up in operable shape. This is a picture of our how our process flow works currently. Through our anaerobic digesters, we compress the gas up to 300 psi. It flows into a scrubbing tower, a water solvent scrubbing tower, where we scrub the carbon dioxide from the gas as it flows upward. From there, it goes into temperature pressure swing absorbent dryers, and we use a desiccant alumina to heat treat the gas for moisture and to prepare it for sale. Some of our quality control monitoring, we monitor the methane BTUs, specific gravity, and dew point prior to sale to PSE. And this was all great, leading into some of our other challenges that came down the road. So currently, right now, our heat demands are 5.7 million BTUs per hour on an annual average, and 2.3 per hour during the summer, and 11.8 potential demand for winter months. The plant hot water heat loop distributes heat from the scrub gas from a scrub gas fired boiler. Now, this was added later in the process from the original design. The original design relied 100% on heat extractors to meet our plant heating needs. And we had a change in our process, which made it to where we had difficulty to be able to meet our plant needs. Turn there. In the 1980s, we had R12 freon for our refrigerant and our heat extractors. But since the initial installation, the refrigerant requirements required us to run R134, and so it made our heat extractors unable to meet our current heating demands. We added another heated extractor in 1995 that is able to come closer to meeting our plant needs, and we also added a gas-fired hot water boiler in 2003 to utilize our plant gas to heat the plant and to meet the heat demands for the digestive process. This is a picture of our current boiler under a maintenance. As you can see, it's able to meet our whole plant needs. Currently, we're doing an alternative analysis to look at that boiler and if there are any other efficiencies that have come since the installation of that boiler to better meet our needs at the plant. This is the heat extractor 5 and the other heat extractors that were installed in 1987. Our heat extractor 5 we use primarily for our summer demands for heating our plant, and it's in current operation at this time. So
The Brown and Caldwell study was focused on a very quick effort to establish a project for the future of digester gas utilization at the South plant. Some of the alternatives we looked at were the alternatives to the direct sale of scrub gas. For example, on-site use of RCNG for fuel, sale to a third party rather than the local utility, and then instead of selling the gas, using it on-site for electricity generation in our CHP turbines that I mentioned earlier. For each biogas and heating system, future modifications were envisioned and 20 alternatives were developed from varying combinations. O&M issues and costs were examined for each system. So for the gas scrubbing system, the issues that are driving possible changes for the future are that the components have a 5 to 10 year life remaining and increasing maintenance costs. The scrubbing system compressor capacities have deteriorated possibly as much as 30%. The controls are vulnerable because they're difficult to replace because the parts are not available, and they also are not we're not able to integrate them with the rest of the plant controls very well. There are operating complexities associated with interruptions in gas quality, that is that if we cannot meet the local utilities requirements for the quality of gas, then we have to divert it into the rest of the system, and there are some bumps there in that the flares, for example, are expecting are normally running on unscrubbed gas, and then all of a sudden they get the high BTU gas, and so that we don't have a completely separate distribution system for scrubbed and unscrubbed gas. But the scrubbing system has worked in the past for the plant, and the sale of pipeline quality gas is generating around $2,600 a day. Issues with the heat extractors, as mentioned previously, they're no longer meeting the plant heating needs due to the change in refrigerant, except in the summer the one newer heat exchanger that was originally on the newer refrigerant is used. Heat pump technology was observed to be slow in responding to changes in heat demand, and the return water can become too hot if they are when they respond slowly. The gas-fired boiler has insufficient capacity to serve peak plant heat requirements. May through September, the boiler can't turn down enough, cycles on and off, and that is drives the switch to the remaining operable heat pump. Another issue with the boiler is that the only redundancy most of the year is the CHP steam turbines, and they are costly to operate. We need to import some natural gas in order to operate the turbines, and the heat recovery system is challenging to bring in and out of service. Other technologies that the Wastewater Treatment Division has experience with is a fuel cell 1 megawatt molten carbonate demonstration project was decommissioned in 2006. There were mechanical and fuel quality issues and difficulty integrating the fuel cell with plant operations. Capital costs are still high, and so fuel cells were not given consideration for future use. Internal combustion engines have a long history at the West Point Treatment Plant, and they were given consideration in Brown and Caldwell's study. However, they didn't get past the screening process in the end because, in part, because air emissions limits have increased the capital cost and the O&M complexity and cost of using engines, which used to be kind of a default simple thing to do. So, for example, we have raw sewage pumps at West Point that are now getting retrofitted with gas treatment, so that they can have a scrubbing technology on the exhaust. So we now have to do exhaust treatment to meet air quality regs. And I can go into more detail on that if people are interested. Other considerations are the fact that the process safety management process regulatory requirement, they amplify the benefits of reliability so that you don't have to be changing things and reevaluating the safety concerning yourself with safety with each change. And the more complex the system, the more burdensome the safety issues become. An interruption in the export of scrubbed high BTU gas creates complications for any on-site end uses of low BTU gas unless there's dedicated distribution piping and flares. Another consideration here at the plant is that there's a synergy between heat extractors and gas scrubbing because the heat extractors cool effluent, which is then used as our medium for gas scrubbing, and the cooler effluent used in the scrubbers results in more effective scrubbing. And there's also synergy between the scrubbing and dewatering processes because the spent scrubbing water is low pH due to dissolved CO2. And when it's mixed with centrate to return to the head of the plant, it helps to control struva. So let's see here. Let's catch up with myself. Did I run over into your slides, Scott?
I think we're okay.
Okay. Oh, this is yours.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
All right. Okay. So in our gas utilization study, I think we on the right page here?
Let's see. Okay. We'll back up one. There we go.
Okay.
Yeah, I already did that one.
So all of our gas systems have a short, medium, and term operating and maintenance cost issues driving some of our modifications. Replacement is coming up, and it's providing us an opportunity to switch from our current technologies to take advantage of some of the more technologies that may be more cost-effective for us in the future. Some of the primary questions for some of our future modifications, well, first is, do we want to continue our commitment to scrub gas? Second would be on-site use of digestion gas versus export. Does it make sense to use our gas here at the plant and insulate ourselves from the electrical grid, or is it more cost-effective and more beneficial for our rate customers to have us sell our gas and potentially buy electricity at a lower market value and provide financial benefit for the community? And so, again, it comes down to power versus gas consumption for heat.
So this is an example of some of the output from the Brown and Caldwell study. And I have to say, this is just one tiny little piece, but it shows some of the financial aspects, and in this case for a possible new gas scrubbing system. You can see the assumed prices there, we're getting 0.5 or 50 cents a therm from PSE, and we have to pay 7 cents a kilowatt hour for electricity. And so with the low cost of electricity and the high value of the scrubbed gas, it's tipping toward continuing with the scrubbing. And I did want to mention that the financial aspects were just one consideration. We had a fabulous job done of, we had three basic categories of criteria for screening future technologies. We had an operational, we defined operational objectives, we defined financial objectives, and we defined energy objectives related to the county goals. And then those were further broken down into things like redundancy, reliability, flexibility under the operational category, and you know, maximizing the reliability on renewable energy within the plant versus the value of it outside of the plant. Things like that were broken down in enormous detail through the study and then all sorted out and put back together into an outcome that through which we determined that we would continue to scrub gas. And so we have a replacement of the scrubbers in the future likely, and that we would continue to export a large quantity of our gas rather than, for example, use our turbines full-time to generate power, which would have been an alternative to that, but it's more valuable sold to the utility. And that for heat, we've left that open right now. There's pros and cons on both sides of either consuming electricity to generate heat in new heat extractors or improving the boiler capacity and consuming gas on site for heat. So that'll be further evaluated in the next phase of the study. And as far as what we do with the scrub gas sale, that'll also be given further consideration to see if we're really maximizing the revenue that we're generating with that.
So in closing, we see biogas as a resource for South Plant, and we're very fortunate to have as many options as we do and to be partners with Puget Sound Energy to meet our plant needs. We're able to optimize our energy mix. We're able to minimize our risk. We're able to maximize our revenue stream from the sale of our biogas. We're also able to serve our community with quality biogas while working to minimize the cost of operation here at South Plant. Improving the reliability and operation will result in fewer disruptions of our biogas production, lower our plant emissions, and help our plant to be a better steward for our environmental and of our environmental and financial resources. So we'd like to thank you for listening to our presentation today.
That's it. Any questions, or do we have time for questions?
We have about a minute, but I'm seeing no questions that have been asked yet. There will be time at the end for questions.
That's great. Thank you.
Thank you, guys. So I guess with no questions, we'll go ahead and move along to Muriel and Jim, their presentation on the Columbia Bowl.
We just been muted.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thanks for being here.
I think we're having some technical issues here.
Michael, do you have me?
Are you on, Jim?
I am on.
You can go ahead.
Okay. This is Jim Brown. I'm an engineer with City of Portland Environmental Services, here with Muriel Gran Turismo, Gisa Teufel. And we're going to do a presentation on the experiences we've had with biogas utilization here at Columbia Boulevard, City of Portland. And provide a little glimpse of where we're headed into the future with biogas utilization. This is a nice aerial view of, in the distance you can see downtown Portland and the Columbia Boulevard plant, 100 MGD dry weather design flow, 350 MGD wet weather daily flow, our wet weather peak flow capacity produce 1.6 million cubic feet of biogas per day. With we have six 2.5 million gallon primary digesters and 4 1/4 million gallon digesters that are part of the original plant. Try and get the slide to move here. So traditionally, we've got the boilers, both for digester heat, facility heat. We have four boilers on site, we also have in 1983 entered into an agreement with an adjoining industry that manufactures roofing products, and they built a gas pipeline. We provided compressed, untreated digester gas to their pipeline, and annually we sell up to $300,000 per year to the roofing company, and they use that to fire the boilers for their manufacturing process. And of course we have flares that are still being used today. So the technologies that we've installed and evaluated and had some experience with here include a fuel cell, microturbines, and internal combustion engine generators. I'll give a brief overview, hopefully here, of how those technologies went for us. The first one I'll do is the 1999. We had a 200 kW phosphoric acid fuel cell. It's an ONZI fuel cell unit. This was touted as a black box, a battery, if you will, with no moving parts. But as you can see from the steam coming out of the top, that's the fuel cell unit there. But there's also the gas pretreatment, compression, and the actual fuel processing unit that are also required for the system to operate. This is a schematic of the fuel cell process. So coming in from the left, the fuel here has to be treated for removal of contaminants that you have in anaerobic digester gas. Prior to going to a fuel processor unit where the digester gas is combined with steam at high temperature and pressure to generate hydrogen-rich gas that then goes into the fuel cell section, the where DC power is generated, that's rectified to be plant, become usable power. Now the project for Portland was funded in a great part by outside sources. We were able to utilize the Oregon Business Energy Tax Credit Program, and we had grants from Department of Defense, Department of Energy, and from our power utility, Portland General Electric, received a grant. So our total cost was a little less than $800,000 for the fuel cell installation. But some of the issues that we had in with the design and installation, the waste heat wasn't at the waste heat generated, the water from the unit was not at a temperature we could utilize for heating digesters. So we weren't actually able to utilize any of the heat from the fuel cell process. And the gas treatment requirements were something that we did not have a good picture of the level of hydrogen sulfide and other contaminants in our gas that required treatment. So the gas scrubbing system for the fuel cell was not as robust as it needed to be. We did not anticipate the requirement for the supply pressure to the fuel processing unit. They have that in a compressor. The water to the fuel cell required treatment, and we underestimated, or I guess we assumed a value of fuel for our digester gas that was incorrect, and the fuel piping was undersized for the unit. As a result, our total output was never up to the 200 kW rating of the fuel cell. So going into the project, we estimated that we'd get about 1.4 megawatt hours per year, offset $60,000 in utility costs, spend $10,000 a year on maintenance, and that the fuel cell stack replacement would be something that we could do on a six-year interval at a cost of $132,000. And this table shows our operational history from 1999 to 2004. Our operational time was never to the level that, although 2000, 2001, it was good, but consistently it was lower. Our maintenance requirements, our instrument tech requirements to keep the system operating were well above what we'd anticipated, and our energy production was much lower than anticipated. And the cost to replace the fuel stack after 5 years was far in excess of what we'd anticipated. So the fuel cell was decommissioned in January 2005. And it's a 30,000-pound paperweight now out in a back lot. We're still working out what to do with it. The benefits of the project, we learned a lot from the project, specifically gas pretreatment and requirements. We learned how to access the Oregon Business Energy Tax Credit, and it was, you know, a good project for demonstration of the technology, and it paved the way for the microturbine project, which I'll talk about next. In 2003, we installed four Capstone 35 kW microturbines. This is the entire package here. Includes the gas compression, pretreatment. Here is a refrigerated dryer. Originally, it was a desiccant dryer. A desiccant dryer is unable to keep up with the moisture removal requirements, so we added a refrigerated dryer. And we've got the exhaust heat recovery. And these are the microturbines here. So each unit, 30 kW, they spin at 96,000 RPM. Total purchase cost was $300,000. The estimated installation cost was $46,000. So our total cost per kW was $2,900. Or $2,600 after the business energy tax credit pass through. These are the numbers on the expected performance. Thermal efficiencies higher, electrical efficiencies a little lower. Overall combined heat and power efficiency of 80%, and they are surprisingly quiet when they're operating. So our history in operating them was very shaky at best. They're very sensitive to fuel quality. The methane content in the anaerobic digester gas varies, and the microturbines were not very happy with that. And they were very sensitive to moisture breakthrough. And so we had a number of issues that we needed to deal with specific to moisture removal. The units were taken out of service during the cogen construction, the engine generator construction project in 2009. And we took a look at the actual operating cost of what our utility offset was, and they are not, we've decommissioned the microturbines. So what we've learned from the microturbines, gas treatment is critical. A robust gas treatment system that deals with moisture, that deals with removal of siloxanes and hydrogen sulfide is a must for gas utilization equipment that's as sensitive as a microturbine. The equipment wasn't set and forget. They couldn't be left without someone attending to its needs fairly consistently. Design issues we had, we were again unable to utilize the hot water generated from the system. If you're going to have a grid independent operation and use it as backup power, you have to actually have to have an engine generator or some other standby power source to be able to power up the ancillary equipment required to operate the microturbines. So as far as grid independent operation, that needs to be taken into consideration. And the user interface and making that work with the plant's SCADA system was something we learned was a challenge. So then in 2009, our next utilization project was internal combustion engine generators. This is one of our Jenbacher 850 kW lean burn engine generators. We have two units. We purchased the equipment and put both the engine generators and all heat recovery equipment, purchase that as a package to make that owner-furnished equipment to a contractor for installation. We also included in the pricing and in the selection of the equipment a 5-year maintenance contract for both the engine and the generator and the electrical control equipment, and use that to evaluate the different bid proposals received, and then entered into a maintenance contract with the, in this case it was Western Energy Systems, for the maintenance of that equipment. Total cost for the facility, $7.9 million. We did receive Oregon Energy Trust Business Energy Tax Credit pass-through of $2 million. So our total cost for the project was $6 million, or $3,500 per kW. Our expected performance for the units, 850 kW, 3.6 million BTUs per hour per unit on the thermal. You can see the electrical efficiency is a little higher on the engine generators than it was for the microturbines. Thermal efficiency is a little lower. Overall combined heat and power efficiency of 84%. They are very noisy, contained within a engine generator building on site. And they utilize a lean burn technology, which with our current air discharge permit, we are not required to provide any sort of scrubbing or treatment for the exhaust from the units. Now, a robust digester gas treatment system is a must, and on this one, we went with a skid-mounted vendor design package that included an iron sponge for hydrogen sulfide removal, booster compressors. It includes particulate filters, moisture filters, and a refrigerated dryer that brings the gas down below the dew point and down to 40 degrees, and then reheats it to make it very dry. And then the gas goes through activated carbon scrubbers for siloxane removal. And next slide is the purchase power. This is from 2005 to 2009, and you can see right there where the engine generator started operation. And our import of power from our utility dropped significantly and has remained at this level since the engine generators have been in service. This is our most recent data on how much power we've generated on site. This is fiscal year 2013, which is July 1, 2012 to June 30, 2013. We generated 43% of our power on site. So the lessons that we've learned, the engine generator project reiterated the need to have a robust biogas treatment system prior to the engine generators. And the one lesson we learned is that you have to have a place to put the waste heat. The engine generators produce more heat than we need in our digesters at some times during the year, and the waste heat generator or the waste heat radiator system has to waste the heat not only of the engine generator but the heat recovered from the exhaust heat recovery system. So the radiator design was they refitted the radiator with a new core, and still on very hot low humidity days we do have issues with getting all of our waste heat out of the system. Coordination with the power company is a must, and making the decisions about whether you're going to have grid independent operation where you can start without power, which again requires engine generator that's diesel powered or some other power source to be able to get the ancillary equipment up and running so you can start the engine generators, and the synchronization equipment to get into phase so that you're you can feed into the plant system, and then you have to make the decision about whether to buy back power or allow the utility to be able to shut down the engine generators if you are producing more power than you're using. In our case, Portland General Electric has the ability to shut down our engine generators at any time for whatever need they have, and they don't utilize that very often. In our case, selling back the power to the utility would put us on a different rate schedule, which was not beneficial. Making a decision on how the engine generators will be housed is important, and the mode for pacing the engine. In our case, we produce less than we use at almost all the time, so the engine generators are running at full speed always, unless we have a fuel shortage, which is fairly rare. And there are significant ancillary equipment required for operation of the engine generators, all of the circulating water circulation, room ventilation, waste heat radiators. There's a lot of related equipment that must be interlocked and provide the controls needed. And then communications and monitoring, the SCADA panel or the user interface for the engine generator set, getting that to talk with our plant SCADA system is something that we are continually trying to work on to get that better. Some of the lessons we learned in operation, performance isn't discharge permit related, so there was a period where getting the operations and maintenance staff to buy into the engine generator project here, that we're not a power station, we're a wastewater treatment plant. But that has changed when the offset in utility bills was realized. As I said, the waste heat system was inadequate, requiring replacement of the waste heat radiator cores. These are the waste heat radiators behind the building. And the iron sponge media life is much shorter than expected. And with that, I'll turn the phone over to Muriel, and she will present the plans for future biogas utilization.
Hi. So after all these experiences with biogas utilization, the realization is essentially that we're still flaring. And to go back to Brian's first slide, is that we do not want to see flaring on a routine basis. So currently, we still flare about 23% of our biogas. And the reason for that is when the cogen project was set up a couple of years back, I think back in 2006, the sizing and design of this was started, a decision was made to size it to get, 70% of the biogas. So now is the time to go to the next project and see, and finding really the most beneficial use for the digester gas that is being flared. So we currently have a project in the engineering group. We're working with HDR on the design of that to determine the most cost-effective and beneficial alternative. So what we did is we looked at five alternatives. We looked at five alternatives. Three of them are essentially expanding on what we currently have, and that's cogeneration with or without storage. And then the alternative four is expanding on sale to industry. But then we have two newcomers, which are alternative three, treating the biogas for vehicle fuel use, or alternative five, which is taking the biogas and use it for biosolids drying. So when we did the alternative analysis, we were at a good point here at the city where we could expand on the traditional way of looking at the direct financial benefits. So what we did is we worked with HDR and they did what they call the sustainable return on investment analysis. And that is a method to monetize the social benefits and environmental benefits of the different alternatives. We thought this was a great way that was in sync with what BES currently does, and it aligns with our strategic levels of service and our climate action plan. So when we did this evaluation, what you can see on this table really is that if you look at the first line of data, is the net financial impacts. The second line is the social and environmental impacts. So that's where we were monetizing those environmental and social benefits. So really what was surprising here is that even just based on net financial impacts, the alternative three, which was taking the biogas and treat it for vehicle fuel use, was the only alternative that was in the positive for us. And then when you add on the social and environmental impacts, that alternative proved to be even much more beneficial. Just one more note on that. The reasons for the conclusion is that on cogeneration, we do not benefit now from the funding sources that we had in the past. So that was one point. We also have no further use for the heat that would be generated by cogen. So that really wasn't proving to be very beneficial to produce more power without the benefits of the heat for us. And then the third reason is that power in the Northwest is based on hydro. So when you combine that with the social benefits of, you know, carbon emission reductions, criteria air contaminant reductions, those benefits were not as high when you were using the biogas for power and heat as opposed to using the biogas for vehicle fuel use. So that led us into developing the alternative three, which is really getting the biogas, treating it to a vehicle for vehicle fuel purposes. And where we're at now is that we have the potential to produce about 1,500 diesel gallon equivalent per day with our excess biogas, and that's enough to power 40 waste haulers or 25 school buses. It's also equivalent to about 25% of the daily fuel consumption by the city fleet. And so that's a very significant number, and which is why we're pursuing that alternative. So why gas treatment for vehicle fuel use? And again, we're in the design phase of this project, so we haven't, we just had a workshop last week, so we're developing this project now. But it's the most valued alternative. It had much more benefits on financially than the other alternatives. Presents some benefits for our North Portland residents with the where the Columbia Boulevard plant is located. There's more opportunities for that type of project for funding and grants, and it represents a stable and domestic source of energy, and we like that idea. And at the end of the day also, the operational cost savings coming from the revenues of the biogas are really significant, because the way we're funding our projects now, $500,000 a year in operational cost savings translates in about $5 million in CIP money savings. So I'll leave it at this and open it up for questions if we have time, or perhaps translate, give it to Brian to open up for questions.
Thank you. That was great. We do have 5 minutes left for questions. I'm not seeing any that have been posted from the audience. I have jotted a few myself. As long as you're on the line there, Muriel and Jim, I had a question. You had your two early projects with the fuel cell and the microturbines were both funded partially with BETSI money, and they both, I don't know if the word failed is correct, but they were discontinued. I was wondering if there was any problems with the funding agencies when those discontinued.
No, there wasn't. They do come through and evaluate and determine that the equipment was installed and operating.
Okay.
Oh. It was installed and operating, and it basically lived its useful life, and then it was determined.
Okay. All right. Great. I don't know if you have an answer for this one or not, but based on your experience and maybe what if you're keeping track of it, do you think microturbines are still a feasible option for municipal use?
We think they're feasible in the right application. We don't think the Columbia Boulevard plant is the right application for them. We do have our plant at Tryon Creek in Lake Oswego, which is an 8.3 MGD plant. We did consider whether or not that might be the right application, but due to other issues we have with development encroaching on that plant site and the future of anaerobic digestion at the Tryon Creek plant is pretty clear that it won't continue to exist on an ongoing basis. The idea of putting them in at Tryon Creek is not something that we're going to pursue.
Thank you. We did get a question from the audience. This one is for Paul.
Yep.
Paul, you there?
Yep.
The question is, you talked about problems with pH on the fog, and the question is, why isn't the fog pre-treated to bring up the pH? Have you thought about that?
It's a consideration. We're trying to design in to design it in the construction so that it's not something we have to continually be adding a chemical to it. I think when we get through with phase two and we have the new equipment that's got the stainless steel cutters and beef that up and see if that will work, and if that works we don't have to worry about it. If it doesn't, and we're still having that problem, we'll have to look at other options. And it really was a combination of not just the pH, but the combination of the aggressiveness of it and the pH with all the grit coming in. So still a work in progress.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Let's see. Here's another question. Maybe a comment. As the water business clearly evolves from treatment disposal to resource/energy reclamation, and given the energy and carbon footprint of most agencies' treatment plants, it seems that co-digestion and co-generation/recovery will be not optional but essential facets of sustainable solids handling moving forward in the 21st century. Okay. There is a question here. How important is it to design and build solids handling systems with such capabilities up front versus trying to retrofit older designs down the road? That's part A, and then B is, under what circumstances should any agency build digestion that does not design and plan up front for such advancement / sustainability in solids process? Well, that's a tough question. I don't know if any of the panel wants to jump in on that, but I think it's extremely case by case. I would agree that if you're designing a new digestion facility, if you don't incorporate some sort of a co-digestion option in it, you definitely need at least to consider it in the layout of your system in terms of the heating and the piping, et cetera. For
electrical.
Future. Electrical, exactly. Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah, one thing we're on that subject, I guess the concern is if more and more people get into co-digestion is making sure you have an adequate source, and as that becomes more of a commodity, to know your market and make sure that that commodity is going to be there for a long time before you put a lot of money into construction.
Yeah, I have one more question from the crowd here, and then we better wrap it up because it was the end here, but this is another one for you.
I had a comment on that last question, though. Can I just add something?
Please.
So part of the study that we're doing here at South Plant in King County is to, we did sensitivity analyses as well that included accepting fat, soil, and grease to enhance the digester gas production, and that will be given further consideration in the future. But there is, this market issue is pretty interesting, and it gets kind of political because as the fat, soil, and grease are viewed as a resource, there becomes competition, I think, for claiming the benefits of that resource. So
definitely,
it'll be, you know, securing the building, you know, securing the supply will be interesting for the future here at South Plant.
Good point. I'm going to go one more question, then we better wrap up. This one's for Paul also. What are you doing to get 1 year out of your iron sponge media? What's your H2S concentration?
I couldn't hear. You were kind of echoing there.
Okay. What are you doing to get 1 year service out of your iron sponge media, and what is your H2S concentration?
H2S out of the digester, I believe, is in around 800 to 1,000 parts per million range. Okay. Not terribly high.
And you're not doing anything special to get a year out of your media? You're just lucky, I guess.
No, we're just, I guess, fortunate. And then the iron sponge removes it down to the parts per billion range.
Yeah. Okay, we got one last one. We better wrap up. I said that before. But this one's for BES. There's a question about what's the uptime of your end buffer units. You know?
I couldn't hear you.
Oh, the uptime for the Enbacher unit at Columbia Boulevard?
We recently completed a complete rebuild of both engine generators. So we were out of service for a month here.
Oh.
But for 2003, that the fiscal year where the data was presented, the uptime was something over 90%.
Okay. Thank you for that. We're going to have to run.
The utility offset per day is significant enough that we'll call out a millwright if the unit is down.
Okay. Thank you. Let's call that good. I want to put a thanks to our presenters. I know this takes a lot of effort and time for you guys. You guys all did a great job. I want to thank you very much. The committee is very appreciative, and hopefully maybe in a few months we'll have another one of these. I think it's very good. And So thanks to our audience for participating, and Michael, do you have any last words?